Before we begin this episode of our Open the Dungeon Halloween Bonanza, we've been asked nicely to include a promo for Infinite Deer.
No, I swear it's around here, honestly. All of these fantasy places sound the same. You there. No, don't be startled. Look, we're Infinite Deer, we're a Dungeons & Dragons podcast. You can find us on iTunes and yeah, wherever podcasts are, but we're lost. Could you help us? We're trying to get to the town. And just a little bit closer to... yes, okay, now the money and your shoes. And don't run! Don't run!
Welcome to yet another Halloween 2020 episode with Mystery Fantasy Dungeon 9000 or MFD9k. So, who are you? What are you playing tonight? And where can folk find you? Starting with Eddie.
Hi, I'm Dennis. I'll be playing Eddie, a drunken monk from Barovia. You can find me on the internet, anywhere you would find MFD9K, because I pretty much host and do all the connections and PR and anywhere else for that.
All right. Next we have Gob.
Hi, my name is Phil, and I really can't be found on the internet unless you know who I am. Good luck. I am playing a tiefling mage. My name is Gobshite Egypt. I managed to say that with a straight face. I'm happy.
Next is Ixion.
Hi, my name is Heather. I usually play Lashka Brickabar on MFD9K. Tonight I'll be playing Ixion, Human Mage.
And finally this episode we have... I've forgotten how to pronounce the name. Avire.
Hi, I'm Jason and I'll be playing Avire, Human Mage. You can probably find me through any way you can find MFD9K, honestly.
So that is the players. Here we go with the story. So as usual for these Penance Halloween specials, you have answered the call for work on the wall of a tavern. As you approach and say, you know, you're there for that job, you are escorted to this back room and you sort of sit around this table and you notice this is the room with the lockable door. As you're sitting around waiting, a very scrawny looking man carrying a handful of books just walks in nervously, locking the door behind him, looking out the window, checking no one's watching, pulling the curtains over before walking over to your table and looking you all sort of one after the other, then going,
hello there, you're the people who replied to my advert, yes?
Yes.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. So, I'm Kelvin, and, you're happy just to go and retrieve the parcel, yes?
I was told there would be money.
Oh, yes, yes. Coin is good, isn't it? Yes. Yes. I will happily pay you. Just please return my delicate cargo to me. That would be wonderful. Thank you.
What exactly are we transporting?
Oh, just a small container. It's nothing to worry about. It's, the main thing you need to know is that the person delivering it to me somehow fell off a small cliff and is sort of in bad condition in a small nearby mountain town. And he's just, the parcel was just apparently just left outside. So I'd imagine that. But if you could just go and collect it and bring it back to me, that would be wonderful.
I don't think that'll be too big of an issue. You've got some direction on where we need to go, then.
Oh, yes, yes. It's a small, small mountain town. Well, say mountain town. It's on the edge of the mountains. It's a small village called Luchgobar.
What's the name of the bar?
Very funny. No, it's a small village called Luchgobar. It's a very, interesting village. You know, I can't just go myself because I have a job here in the city.
I'm sure we can get your parcel back for you. Is there anything we should know about it? Any special instructions?
Oh, it's just a small pair of fuzzy creatures. There's nothing to worry about. Yes, the small, fuzzy thing. Lovely, fluffy ears, apparently. They're fine. They're completely safe. It's nothing to worry about.
What, like kittens?
Yes. Let's say yes. Yes, they're like kittens, yes.
Oh, we should go retrieve two kittens for you. Gotcha.
Yes, yes. Just kittens with bigger ears and, slightly sharper claws. But yes, yes, kittens, yes, kittens, yes.
Out of curiosity, what is the race of the person talking to us?
He is... He's a relatively middle-aged to something about 50-year-old human. He's quite scrawny. He looks like he's very much someone that works behind a desk rather than someone that actually does any sort of manual labor.
What are these things called? I get the feeling they're not exactly kittens. I want to make sure I'm retrieving the correct thing.
That's very funny. They're small creatures. You don't need to know the names of them.
Well, then how shall we recognize them? I mean, if you'd like, for the fee, we can simply go to local bar, procure two kittens in return.
No, no, no.
I can put weights on their ears and make them slightly larger.
I suppose I should tell you the full tale. About 3 weeks ago, I was attending the usual sort of end of the month gathering at my guild, and I got rather inebriated, and after a couple of very sour whiskies, I was approached by a gentleman. He offered to sell me these two creatures, and me being rather inebriated, thought it was a fantastic idea. And I woke up the next morning, realizing that he'd taken not only all of my money, but half the money of my guild. So I rushed outside as fast as I could, and I tracked this gentleman down and said, you know, I need that money back. You took advantage of me when I was drunk, and after many threats of legal action, he told me that it would be okay and he could reverse it and give me my money back. Unfortunately, he had already ordered the creatures. So we struck up a gentleman's agreement that once the creatures arrived in the city, I would bring them to him and then he would give me my money back, so neither of us are out of pocket. Now the problem is that when traveling here, the caravan sort of fell off the cliff, as I said, and I can't really replace the money if I don't have the creatures.
Was the caravan attacked?
I don't believe it was attacked. I mean, these things must just happen. You know, creatures falling off of, you know, creatures, you know, being transported across the land. I mean, accidents must just happen. He sort of starts rustling through his pockets. And he goes, well, are any of you familiar with, And he sort of leans in towards you and goes, are Arthacadians?
Well, I mean, of course I am, but perhaps you should enlighten my colleagues here.
They're very magical creatures. I'm sure you know the distinguishing features of them, if you're... yes?
Ears and... of course.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, I don't need to mention it out loud. I feel so much better, thank you.
I've got a 6 in Arcana. I ever heard of these.
Roll intelligence.
13.
13. You've heard of them. They're very... you thought they were mythical creatures. They're not real. They're things of, you know, fairy stories kept in, like, you know, big, like, grand wizards' dungeons and stuff like that. They're not real.
So, you lost half your guild's money on a fairy tale?
No, I assure you they're real. They're real, and that's what makes this more, delicate a situation. You see,
are you sure you weren't just, for lack of a better word, duped, kind sir?
The biggest problem is...
He sort of leans in really close to you at this point and goes,
my receipt is not for just one. It's for a pair. A breeding pair.
So about this time, I think Eddie is going to just kind of lean over nonchalantly and start sniffing the old man. And then after a good long minute of sniffing around the old man, he's going to look back at Gobshit and give him a thumbs up like he believes him.
Well, worst case scenario, this will be good for a laugh.
And you know all the precautions you need to have for these creatures, yes?
Refresh my memory.
Well, your friend there says that they know it.
He just said violently, no.
Refresh my memory. I appear to have been a great deal drunk last night when he was talking.
Oh, well. They're lovely creatures, and they love their ears being scratched. Yes, that'll do.
He agrees and nods. And head scratches will definitely do.
Yes. Just don't creep up on them.
They've got a special diet, right?
You could put it like that, yes.
Remind me, what's their favorite again?
Well, it's,
Soylent Green.
They are very fond of humanoid and any sort of human-shaped creature flesh. But they're very pretty creatures. They've got lovely ears. They look marvelous when you, like, comb them and groom them. I mean, they're not as dangerous as they, as they could be. They're still quite young.
But old enough to be a breeding pair.
Lost in a valley by themselves. For how long?
Around two weeks.
2 weeks. Surely that's not long enough for them to have made a nest, feasted upon a couple of local people, and perhaps made some spawn.
Of course not.
Then I'm sure you won't mind paying us half up front, half upon completion.
I would if I had money. I have nothing until I get my funds back. But I will pay you very well once I can hand this barbarian that sold me these creatures.
Where is this barbarian that sold you these creatures?
He was a traveling merchant. He comes to visit this tavern every evening.
What's his name?
I think it was Graveheart.
What does he look like?
Oh, he's around my height, long black robe, quite nice cheekbones.
Can I make like illusions, magical version of a sketch artist?
Yeah.
Granted, I have no
roll to see how well it goes, but yes.
Boom shakalaka, 13.
Yep. So you conjure this image of this black-robed figure in front of you, and he goes,
it's a very nice trick, but he looks a little bit paler than that.
Well, I make him paler. Try and, hone in on what he looks like.
I think you're misunderstanding my subtlety. He's paler than that.
Oh, he's dead.
No. I wouldn't do a deal with a necromancer. What are you talking about?
Of course not. He merely looks like a necromancer?
Oh, yeah. It's a fashion statement, I'm sure.
Ah, okay. I make him sure that I re-alter the image to where it looks not quite like a necromancer. Does that kind of look like him?
Vaguely, yes.
Okay.
So, just to summarize here, we're going to locate two nightmare creatures that you have misplaced for 2 weeks, that you have certainly not purchased from a necromancer, correct?
Basis is all correct, yes.
Fantastic.
I mean, I'm sure people of your caliber are able of, to sort of get past these small hurdles.
Okay. I know these things are mythical creatures. And in my character's head, there is a reasonably decent chance that this man has been duped. However, there is also a reasonable chance that this man somehow managed to convince a barbarian necromancer to send a breeding pair of whatever those were. I can't pronounce that right now. And off with them, who got loose, attacked the caravan. It fell off into a valley. And now I have this hideously, possibly monstrously powerful creatures at the bottom of the valley. We should probably try to retrieve them before they flood the world with whatever it is. How powerful and scary are these? Like, what do I know about them from my whopping 13?
Do me one more just plain d20 roll. If you get above, let's say if you get 11 or above, I'll tell you the big thing that he's not telling you about them.
Oh no, I'll total 9. If it's flat, 9.
No,
if
I have to add any bonuses, he sort of smiles at you awkwardly, and he sort of goes,
there's nothing else. Nothing at all.
Okay. Alright.
They don't fly, do they?
Oh god, it'd be terrifying if they could fly.
Okay, well, anything else we'll try our best to handle.
Yes, just just remember and take care, and yes, please just bring them back to me. I want my life back.
What kind of guild do you belong to?
I'm the treasurer of the Guild of Accountants.
Oh my.
You're
not at all like the Mafia.
We wear suits on occasion.
I see your knees are intact.
I think before we go, Eddie's gonna walk up and pat the guy on the back and play him a small squeeze box song and then walk out.
He informs you that there is a coach leaving to go to this village tomorrow morning. Is there anything you wish to do before you get that coach?
Do we want to try to talk to the necromancer? Not necromancer?
Yes, very much so. Oh my god, yes.
You see someone who vaguely looks like him. He appears as it gets very close to, like, chucking out time in the tavern. You notice him going up to nobles and sort of showing them a piece of paper, and as if he's trying to hard sell the really drunk on something.
That sounds like our guy.
Yes.
I'll approach.
So you walk up near him and he goes, "Ah, hello there. Had a nice few drinks tonight."
Oh, so many drinks. I've had so many.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. I mean, have you ever thought of the joy of owning a mythical creature?
A mythical creature?
Yeah. I mean, it's strictly for mages, but...
What kind of creature?
Oh, it's small and fuzzy with nice big fluffy ears.
It sounds so cute.
Oh, they are. They're very cute. Only cost you... let's see.
Sort of looks you up and down and goes,
"You look like you've got a pretty penny. Let's say... 30,000 gold.
I could get a kitten for much less than that. You're gonna have to sell me, buddy.
Oh no, it's all up to you if you want a mythical creature. I mean, kittens come and go, but have you ever wanted your own beast that could easily devour any of those annoying people that come to your door? The ones that beg charity. You could just set this slightly larger kitten on them. And it would just take the problem away. Brilliant at parties.
No, I don't think that I've wanted to make them die, no.
Oh, well, But if you change your mind, come find me. I'll be here.
Okay, honey. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, kitten.
I'll walk back to the group, and that was not at all useful.
All right. Are you doing anything else about it before you head off in the caravan in the morning?
Anyone else want to talk to this guy?
Is anybody here good at threatening? I'm not very good at threatening.
I am. I don't think I would be either.
We are three wizards and a drunken gnoll, so no, I don't think we got threat.
Oh no, a gnoll could be kind of intimidating depending on how it protects itself.
Well, I don't think if anybody's got anything, I think we're ready to move on.
Yeah.
I'm just glad I gave Deadfly a chance to use that voice.
Alright, so you all find yourselves accommodation for the evening. So the next morning you get on this caravan that goes a very rickety road straight north. As you get to literally the foot of the mountains in early evening, you sort of arrive in this very small hamlet that is Luchgobar. There are five main obvious locations. There is the town hall, which looks like a converted barn, which has been a converted barn and a schoolhouse and all these other things. You can tell this by the fact that the sign has been crossed out and written directly above it, and then continued to be crossed out and written above, and crossed out, written above, and crossed out, written above, depending what's happening. The next building is the inn. It's a sort of very half barrel shaped inn. It looks like it was built by what looks like some sort of human miners, although everyone around looks like they're dwarvish. The third location is the town square, which has a quite large fountain with three dog statues on top of it. And there's a set of shops, effectively. There's like a blacksmith stall, there's a caravan that sells like alchemy goods, there's a stables and a small flower stall where all the flowers look a bit, basically look a bit old, they don't look like they're, like it's been restocked recently. There is the fourth location is there's like a sort of house standing alone with a very overgrown garden all around it. And finally, there is a path leading up to what looks like the forest and then onto the mountain path. For your first choice of early evening, you have the choice of the town hall, the inn, or the market square. Where would you like to go?
I'm thinking market square.
Good spot to get a bunch of information real quick.
I was thinking something similar. I was thinking also the town hall, but Market Square would probably get us a lot of information from the townspeople directly.
Maybe a survivor.
Maybe. So hearing no opposition, we will go to the town square.
As you arrive into the village, a small stable boy comes out from the stables and takes the horse in and unloads your bags from the car. You are now standing in the market square. In front of you there is this massive fountain, as I said, with three dog statues on top of it. You see the blacksmith stall in front of you, which looks as a quite large, sort of hefty looking blacksmith working it, who's, everyone you see at this point is dwarven, unless I say otherwise. There's a quite, as I said, large blacksmith in front of you. To your left, there is a caravan stall with like various potions and powders sort of lying out in front of it, the owner of which seems to be sort of sitting in shadows and looking out, and occasionally you can see the like someone's moving himself in his seat, but does seem to like sitting in the shadows. You see, as I said, the flower stall with the flowers look like they're all beginning to die, but doesn't seem to anyone immediately selling stuff from it. And there's the stables itself. I'll let you decide what you want to do.
I think it would be a good idea to talk to, so there was like a caravan stall. Did the whole caravan fall off the cliff or only part of it?
From what you've understood, from what you've been told before, it seems the entire caravan, horses and all.
And we could talk to them and find out if that road itself is just known for being treacherous or if they've lost many caravans along that path.
Lead on, Aver.
All right, then I'll walk up to the stall.
As you walk up, you hear a It's going to sound like a familiar voice, but it is meant to be different.
Hello there. What have you got in store for me? Do you need some alchemy?
Not really. I'm more looking for some information.
Oh, I see. I'm all ears.
And you see him lean forward, and you notice in the sort of setting-ish sun, that sort of evening light, you see that this is definitely a tiefling.
Well, and my character will lean in a little bit too. We're here looking for a caravan that seems to have slipped traveling from...
You're here to find the poor boy being looked after by Maud. You can find him in that hut later.
And he gestures towards the house with the overgrown garden.
She's out at the moment. I think she's shouting at the little brat.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate that.
Well, if you need any alchemy, you know where to find me.
I'll keep that in mind. Is that road known for being dangerous?
Well, I travel it every 4 to 5 days in between here and the other side. I've never had a problem.
Perhaps it was something they were transporting then.
Me, but looking at his injuries, it looks very strange for a full cart to just barrel straight through the fence and fall.
Oh, so it wasn't an open cliff? Something.
Oh, we had to put a fence up there about 5 years ago because we had all these accidents.
Well, thank you again for your information, and if we need anything of an alchemical persuasion, I'm sure we'll swing back by. I would sit down at least 1 gold and kind of nod to him as thanks for the information. And then I'd return back to my group.
You have gold, it seems. Well, you're one higher than anyone in this.
Is this town not doing so well?
It's mostly a barter system.
I did note the declining population on the sign on the way in.
More will come in the next few days. It's their whacking festival.
Character would almost start to chuckle a little bit. Whacking festival?
Yes, it's some anniversary of them chasing rats out of the mines. Personally, I don't approve of such things. If you ask the other people,
gestures towards the blacksmith,
they're all for it.
And at this point you hear, "Here, what are you saying about me now?"
Quiet you, they'll come speak to you if they have business with you.
The tiefling just turns back to you and goes,
"Apologies, he's quite rude, isn't he?"
That's quite alright. Now, thank you again for the information. As I said before, we'll swing back by if we have need of your goods.
Anytime.
With that, my character will, Avair, will return to the party and pass on what he knows. Seems the person we're looking for is over in that house there with the flowers out in front.
He understands alchemy?
Yes, he is an alchemist, or at least he sells alchemical goods.
Anybody else here know alchemy? I know nothing of it.
I know nothing of it either.
I do not specialize in alchemy.
Do you have a point? No, I mean like a single skill point?
No.
Oh, okay. We know nothing of alchemy.
That's not what my character would say, though.
Ah.
He did mention that apparently wealth is not a very big thing in this town, or at least it's on a decline. However, he did also mention that they have a whacking festival coming up soon. Seems to be a big thing with most of the villagers here. It seems to be connected with them chasing rats out of the mines, or some kind of rodent.
That's, I mean, any reason for a festival, right?
Hearing the thoughts of a whacking festival and hearing about the thought of rats, Eddie is immediately going to pull out his frying pan and start looking at the ground.
Oh, honey, no.
Eh?
No, that's not the answer.
He will slowly put his frying pan away.
Shall we speak with the blacksmith then?
Eddie will nod and agree.
So you turn towards the blacksmith and you hear a... Oh, hello there.
Oh, there we are, small master. Are you here for the whacking festival?
And he sort of looks at Eddie.
Hold up the frying pan again.
I've got one for your child here. One second.
And he rustles behind his, the stall and he pulls out this quite vicious looking mallet. And he just holds it up towards Eddie and goes,
that looks about your size. There you go. Just remember, when you see that rat, it marred.
Just gonna look at the frying pan, look at the stick, look at the frying pan, put the frying pan away, put two hands on the stick.
Oh, your offspring's got quite a swing there.
Oh, no. You're too kind.
Oh, you know, any excuse for the kids to go and whack that rat?
Eddie, do you have money for the nice man?
He points at Gob.
Okay, son, well, it's coming out of your allowance this week. And how much good, sir?
Oh, I just want to see his smile on his face. You just take that one. Tell your friends, though. You know, mate, Gerard's made a lot of hammers this year. He's happy to give them away.
Very, very kind of you, sir. Seems you have a bit of a dislike for the stall owner there. Everything okay?
Well, Grunnins is always planning things, you see. He's always a wee bit shifty, but then I suppose he is a tiefling.
And at that point, I'll step a little bit further into the light. I'm sorry, he's a what?
Oh, he's just a little bit different. That's all I'm saying. Likes the shadowy arts, does Grunnins. You know, you ask him if he wants a cup of tea, and he goes, no, it's not dark enough. Starts doing some weird thing with putting his finger in the cup.
Stuck between laughing, taking notes for future reference. This is awesome.
I mean, I can't say I know much about tiefling tradition, but I do know a lot about living in a mountain town. When I get up in the morning, I have a nice strong brew. Grannins, he likes some sort of, well, it looks like some sort of coffee, really, but I think it's made with some sort of chestnuts or something. Always smells quite weird.
As a tiefling, I have no idea what he's talking about, right?
Yep.
Okay, sounds good.
Well, I'm sure we all have our own rituals that would look strange to outsiders.
Oh, I'm sure they would. I know some people, like Grannins, for example, don't like the Whacking Day Festival. But, I mean, you know what harm is there, you know? Jack gets dressed up, children run after him with sticks. Happy day all round.
I have an odd little question. The couple weeks back, caravan went off the caravan trail.
Oh, why? It was a horrible accident, that.
I guess it fell down the mountainside into a valley, I presume.
Well,
right?
It went flying off the cliff and just plummeted straight down. I mean, Daddy found him, brought that poor creature back here, and he brought him to Maud, and Maud's been healing him back to health. But those horses... I've not seen any like it. It looks like they crumpled fully when they hit the ground.
Did you watch them go off? Did someone watch?
But when Daddy told me there was, you know, a wreck out there, I went out to make sure nothing's gonna catch fire. You don't know about what people have been taking in caravans.
This is true. One last thing. The mines, do they happen to have an outlet down there in the valley?
Oh no, no. Those mines have been sealed off for a long time now. Daddy wouldn't let anyone go down there. No, after what happened to McCafferty.
What happened to McCafferty?
Oh, he got crushed by a large rock.
And Daddy?
He used to run the inn, you see, before Reese took over. And he was down the mine, and he shouted up someone, and he sort of went, you know, I'm down here, but the vibrations, you see, they caused it to shake, and then this big rock just went, boom, and crushed it. After that, Reese took over the inn.
And Daddy says it's unsafe to go down there. So we blocked it up. No one's been down there since.
Okay, so the mines are blocked up on this end, right?
Oh, aye. Every access we know about it, Daddy's been round to make sure it's sealed.
Who is Daddy, by the way?
Well, he's the goat farmer.
The goat farmer.
Aye.
Sealed up the mines.
Well, he's like the village elder, but he's not, because that's Aris. But he kind of gets all the work done, and you know, everyone knows, you know, if Daddy says something, it's probably for the best.
So he's a authority figure for this town?
Oh, you could say that. Aye, he's sort of the voice of reason. You know?
And Aris?
Oh, Aris is an old, he's a nice old gentleman, but he's a bit stuck in his ways. He just wants an easy life, you know, left alone with his djinn.
So Eddie is going to look at the rest of the group after having a little fun with his little whack-a-stick, and he's going to make motion towards the stick, hold up two fingers, and then make a small ball with his hands. In other words, he's inferring to, are we here to whack the fur balls? We're here to collect.
Are you referring to me, young master? Are you referring to your friends?
We're here looking for some, that caravan that went off the side of the cliff. We're here to see if we can, gather some of the cargo that went missing.
Oh, and with all those books yours?
They may have belonged to our boss.
Oh, right, well, I've just taken them all along to Ethel in the town hall. She says gonna use them to teach the children.
Out of curiosity, have you heard of a merchant named Graveheart? And he looks kind of like, and I do the little spell, this.
Oh, that's a frightening individual, that. I'd recognize that if I saw it. No, I ain't seen anyone like him.
Okay.
Oh, I can see me nightmares already. Don't be showing me that again.
Terribly sorry about that.
You haven't seen a sort of middle-aged dwarf woman walking around in the forest area on your way in?
Did we?
No.
Well,
sorry,
you
can't.
If you see one, just let you know. Just tell me what's happened to her, because it's been a few days now, and Emmeline sort of disappeared, and her stalls begin to look a bit tragic.
Can you describe what she looks like?
Well, she's about...
Yeah, we could kind of draw her.
Same age as me, really. But she looks a lot younger. And she's okay. Lovely blonde hair. And, yeah, you know, wears all these summery dresses all the time.
Blonde, dwarf, summery dresses.
Oh, yeah,
can I create an illusion of that?
Well, she usually goes gathering flowers in the forest every morning. But for the last few days, she's not been here. I mean, young Luther over there, he's been badly looking for her. He misses her, but he says he's gonna go and look for her, but I keep telling him, you better not go look for her, because if she's eloped, she's eloped with a young gentleman, he won't want anything to do with you.
Is the forest the same way as, same general direction as the valley where the crash occurred?
Oh, it's up by Daddy's farm. You just go along that way, and he points to the road leading up through the forest. So go along that way, follow it round, you'll find Daddy's farm with the goats. And then, up next to that, you'll see a big pile of rubble. Well, wood. And that's the caravan.
Oh, that's awesome. Okay.
But I wouldn't go out this time of night, though. It's getting quite dark.
Are there bandits?
Well, not really, no. But there's, you know, the odd thing might come down from the mountains. You know, it's a... Might be fairy stories to you folk, but we mountain people always saying that the nighttime is the nighttime for, you know, those things that come down from the mountains and they go back for the morning. Sometimes we leave a saucer of milk out.
You're not talking about Erythocradians, are you?
About what?
No.
Oh, no, I'm talking about badgers.
Badgers.
Frightening.
Why, you ever seen a big badger leave out of the night? Bloody frightening.
Almost as bad as a raccoon, I imagine.
Well, not seen a raccoon. I've definitely had my fair share of badgers, though. I had to beat one off with a spade once.
Thank you for the tip. We will certainly keep our eyes open for badgers.
Aye, well, you take care of yourself. Looking forward to seeing you at Whacking Day.
Sounds like a blast.
I can't not hear Wanking Day. I honestly can't. And I'm dying laughing inside because it's just great. Okay, I huddle back. I come up the groups there. I just kind of tug them away and I go, okay, so the monsters are out. The monsters are feeding.
Yep, that sounds about right.
And I don't think we're going to get paid if we kill them.
I don't think so.
I would kind of like to live.
Yeah, if it comes to a choice between living and money, I'm going to have to choose the living.
Money does you no good, Dad.
We need to see if anyone else has gone missing in the last, well, since Emmeline. Because if it's been a few days since they've eaten, they're going to be hungry.
I mean, there's still always her stall to check, and I guess what, the stables and the fountain still to go to in this area.
Yeah.
With whatever time we have left in this area.
You can basically explore as much as you want.
Is there anything special about the fountain other than the statues?
It just seems to be quite a sort of large fountain. It's got these three stone dogs on top of it.
Ooh.
Not much else to say about it.
Eddie's going to run up. Can Eddie get up to where the dogs are because he wants to try and profile them next to him?
Sure. So I'm sure someone can give you a boost up to it and then you'll be on the same platform.
Alright, so Eddie's going to get up there and try and profile himself like the rest of them and get next to each of them, see if he looks like any of them, even though they all probably look the same because they're made of stone.
Mm-hmm. Two of them look like mastiffs and one of them looks like a sheepdog.
That's adorable.
I know. Our son is so cute.
He's growing up so fast.
And with a stern nod, I'm going to bop each of them on the head with my new stick and then I'll get down and we can go wherever.
Alright. So are you doing heavy bops or just light bops?
I have a choice. What would Eddie do? I guess if I do heavy bops, you're going to require a roll, no?
Well, they are stone statues, so heavy bops might break them.
A stick versus a stone statue? I'll take that bet.
Alright.
See, you saying stick, but I swear I heard the blacksmith say hammer.
It's a mallet. It's not a stick.
Well, isn't a mallet just a stick with a knob on the end?
It's a stick with a heavy weighted knob on the end, yes.
Well, go forth and make magic.
Alright. Do your rolls. Alright. You smack the first one. It just makes a sort of ringing sound through thing. You smack the second one, and just makes the same sort of ringing sound, although you do break one of the ears off. And as you go to smack the third one, it moves in front of you, becoming a very large, fluffy-eared dog that goes and then jumps off into the bushes behind you.
I'm going to run behind Daddy, or Gob.
Can I cast before it makes it to the bushes?
You can try, yes.
Grease!
Roll.
Oh. D20?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
14!
So what did you cast, sorry?
Grease.
Alright, go.
How to make it lose its footing.
Alright, you shoot grease, it just sinks into the sort of dirt all around. It does seem to slide a little bit, but it's well into the bushes before you. And as you sort of look through the bushes after it, you can't see any sign of it.
Okay. What the hell was that?
I'm going to look around. Does anyone seem to be, like, surprised by that? Like, any of the stall vendors or anything like that?
Well, the blacksmith has back to you, so he won't have seen anything. You do notice the tiefling sort of looking quite, like, he's looking at you quite curious about what's just happened. You know the kind of way someone looks and then goes, no, that can't be what I've seen. No, I can't have seen that.
I don't think that was normal for these people. That's...
Neither do I. I want to talk to the tiefling.
All right.
I go up to the tiefling and I go, have you ever heard of a Tharakadian? A Rafakadian?
His eyes grow wide and he goes,
you're pulling my leg, are you not?
I think that you, my friend, may be able to shine a great deal of light upon us. So let me paint you a picture. We have an idiot who happens to be the guild secretary for the accountants guild back in the city. A man with access to a vast sum of money. This moron gets drunk. And up pops this guy named Graveheart. And I make a illusion of Graveheart.
Okay. A necromancer.
Well, no. Not the necromancer, and I mockingly try to do the other guy's voice. No, this piss-drunk idiot managed to get half of the guild's money and buy a breeding pair of these things from this person. Yes, a breeding pair. We are missing some people locally, no? And I'm afraid
of saying there's a breeding pair of Arathacadians in this village.
No, because you're still here. There's a breeding pair of them off the valley, possibly down in the mine. Now, you know more than we do. And
well, I will be packing my things and leaving as fast as I can, but I appreciate the heads up. What can I do in return?
Tell me as much as you know about Arathacadians, or Arathacadians, or whatever they are.
From a very particular realm, very familiar to tieflings, well, those that dabble in the very strong mage arts. They're mostly used like crocodiles, only a lot more fluffy. They'll devour a corpse in several hours. Completely, even lick the blood off the floor. The best thing about them that people love is they can polymorph.
Into, say, a large dog?
No, that's usually their standard form. The only advantage you have against an Arathacadian is that they can't move in polymorphed form. They have to become their original form to move.
Eddie is pulling on Gob's outfit and pointing at the fountain when he talks about polymorph.
I look back real quick. None of the other statues have gone away, have they?
Nope.
And I look back at him. Can I conjure a picture of what I saw in that brief little moment?
Yes, that's definitely a young adolescent Rathacadian.
And
I'm going to start packing my caravan. Excuse me a second.
And he starts hurriedly throwing things into the caravan.
And I hop the counter with him. I'm not going to interfere with him. I just need him to keep talking while we have time.
All right.
And for the player's knowledge, the size of the young adolescent was a dog size. Relatively large dog, so like a Great Dane.
Actually, no, let's say about the size of like a lab or a golden retriever.
Okay, medium dog. All right, cool, we go. All right, so they can't move when they're in statue form. Let's say that you were trapped and it was a life and death thing. What would you want to have with you?
Against one?
Against two. Possibly with young.
I really wouldn't know what's best against them. They like fire, I know that for sure. Fire regenerates them, it's some magical thing.
Does it stand to reason that, as somebody who's really, really, really good at arcane stuff, does it stand to reason that if fire regenerate, cold makes them cold as...
I don't know much about that, I'm afraid. I just know that the breeder that I used to know a very long, long, long time ago in a world before I came here, he used to get the eggs and encase them in fire, and they would hatch within days.
Lovely. the mines don't go down to magma, do they? Okay, wrong person to ask that. Tiefling, fluffy crocodile, lick for blood. They can polymorph, can't move in.
The only thing I would say is, don't go anywhere alone. They're, they're quite fast and, quite hungry. And they're very quick at killing. They can probably carry a horse at this, even at that size.
Do you happen to remember the breeding cycle? Like, is it less than 2 weeks?
That's around a 2 week gestation period, if I remember right. They lay usually a clutch of around 30 to 50 eggs.
Eddie's gonna have a shocked look on his face because he actually gets time.
Okay. Tell me, if you were wanting to get a... You know the people here locally better than I do. If you were wanting to get the town mobilized to save its entire skin and possibly this entire continent / geographical area, would you go to either Eris or Daddy?
From this village, you probably want the two intelligent ones. Not that I really like either of them, but Daddy and Maud are probably your best bets. Although I suppose if you can bribe Harris to be on your side, you might get more, but he's an old fool. He's not really worth your time if you're desperate.
Harris is the town elder.
He's a bumbling old drunk.
Daddy and Maud are probably the people that we need to go after.
Maud is, well, she's what you'd call a village witch. She does a lot of healing. When she thinks something and puts her foot down, people actually listen. And Daddy, of course, is the one that most people listen to, for he has what more reasonable answers than most, and unlike Harris, he actually listens.
Daddy lives out on the farm, ironically right next to the place.
He comes back at night to drink in the inn, but that's really the only time he's in the middle of town unless he's speaking to Harris.
And Maud, where could we...
She's in that hut there.
He points to the building with the overgrown garden.
Maud.
She's the one looking after Daddy. The boy.
Yep, so Daddy will be at the inn. Maud will be at the...
The garden house.
Yeah, the garden house. The Arathacadians. I know I'm mangling that, but close enough. So the Arathacadians, do they happen to leave any spore? Any traces?
They're not the most tidy if they've brought something back to their den, but apart from that, I don't think they leave much behind. They're quite expert hunters. That's why they're usually used for sport quite a lot in the darker realms.
Are these creatures that need to eat every day, or...?
If they're about to produce eggs, they'll probably have eaten quite a lot. I think about it, that might be where the horses went.
That makes sense, yes?
There was a small debate the other day. Jack and, Luther over where the horses that were killed in the caravan crash actually went. Neither of them seemed to know where they went and thought...
Well, I think we've solved that mystery. We've just got to see if they will believe us.
Yes, and if we had proof, that would be best. I don't know if a polymorph Irathacadian got hit by a mallet, would blood have been left? Or would a chunk broke off? Or what? And I go, hey, are you going to be here in like 3 minutes?
I'll be here for about another 10 minutes till I get my horse out the stables, and then I will be gone.
Okay. Hey man, can you guys hurry up? I pop back over the counter, rush toward the fountain, and look around. Do I see any broken bits of Arathacadian? Or,
you know,
it doesn't look right.
You just see the broken ear of the second statue that Eddie hit.
Okay. And
that Eddie actually got to hit the third one.
It moved just before he hit it.
Okay. Okay. Expert Hunter, Clutch, 30 to 35. Breeding Pair, 2 week oration time. Those things will be ready to pop just around time of the Wanking Festival. Sorry, Whacking Festival. And everybody's going to be running around with little stick mallets, trying to whack rats the size of large dogs that are going to eat them.
Yep.
Eddie holds his whacking stick high.
Eddie, you've earned your allowance this week.
You've done well, boy.
Hey, I go back and slide across the counter. Do they like their ears scritched? Is there anything weird with them in milk?
I'm aware. I mean, I don't know anyone that got close enough to scritch their ears, if I'm honest, but they do look attractive, I guess.
Okay.
As for milk, I have no idea how it would affect them.
Right. And lastly, the books are in the town hall, right?
Books.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Are you just asking in general?
Yeah, I'll ask in general, hopefully. Yeah.
The books hopefully were, the books the blacksmith took from the caravan crash, he took to the town hall.
I'm going to pull on Gob's outfit and point to the statue and then point to the town hall. As in, could, like, it disguise itself as books? And then look to Ixion and AVR afterwards, like, am I the only one?
Maybe? We'll be looking at those books either way.
If we have time. Hey, do you happen to have anything that, seeing as how I'm basically getting you out of here 24 hours earlier than you would have known. Any tips?
I would suggest you run and keep running. If they have eggs and they hatch, by more than the countryside that is reduced to rubble.
Sounds. Do you have anything that makes a loud boom that doesn't involve fire? I'm told that avalanches are a thing that happen. I mean, they dislodged a rock.
I don't seem to have much.
And he has to sort of look around and he goes,
I have a couple of very simple flashbangy firework kind of things. Might as well take them and me very well.
He hands them to you as he walks past to get his horse and you hear the blacksmith go, here, what are you taking your horse out this time of night for?
I'm leaving.
You what? The Wacken Festival's only in a few days. You usually stay for that.
I suggest you leave.
Oh, don't be so stupid, Grenins. It's not gonna happen. I mean, whatever it is you've got so worried about, it's not gonna happen. Those demons you see ain't real.
I am a demon, and demons are real.
Oh, stop that. You know, they're not real. You know, they're not gonna come take over the world or anything like that. Come on, Grenins, have a laugh for once.
I think they're going to eat the world and shit it out, actually. Or at least all the people in it.
Oh, you're just having a laugh.
Well, no, I'm worried enough to talk to Maud.
Oh, well, you know, I suppose if you're that serious.
And he starts just he just packs the last of his things and just picks up his bag and heads off towards the inn. And as the tiefling basically just attaches his horse to his cart, so the tiefling heads off. The blacksmith has headed off towards the inn. Are you wanting to do anything else at this location before you move on?
Yeah.
What do you want to
do? As soon as possible, I want to search for that alchemist stall.
The alchemist stall has just basically left because he's just put all his stuff in the caravan and just taken off.
Yes. Did he leave anything of value behind? And it is
a sort of small wooden stool.
I sit on it. How comfortable is it?
It sort of wobbles to one side when you sit on it, like one leg is not as long as the other two.
Oh, not very. Okay. And other than that, the stall is pretty much empty.
Yeah, other than that, he's pretty much thrown everything else into the caravan left.
Okay.
Does anyone want to check out the abandoned flower stall or the stables before we head to the inn? So I think that's probably a good idea for the next stop.
The inn gets us daddy. who has reasonable answers and will listen, but we have absolutely no proof other than the fact that we know what it is and there's disappearances. Maud, however, is a village witch, and she might have a little more arcane knowledge and might actually be a little more scared of what a wreath of whatever it is. Otherwise, we're saying the boogeyman's coming to town and we have no real proof other than that the fact that people are missing. If we go to Maud and we say the boogeyman's coming to town, oh, by the way, it's this, which happens to be this, 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 and this, which explains this, 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 and this. Hey, can you help out? Because it looks like your town's going to die in 2 days. We might get a better answer.
Yes, but it's also possible that if we talk to Daddy, he lives where the caravan crashed and in the woods where the girl disappeared, so he might have noticed happenings in that area if that's where they're staying.
Do we want to do the flower stall or the stables before we leave this time slot?
Is there anybody in the stables?
The stables only has the stable boy and a couple of horses.
Okay, I would just have one quick question for the stable boy then.
Yep.
Which is, if I were looking to get warm, where would be the best place in this area to go?
Looking to get what?
Warm? If I were cold. If I wanted
the inn, I imagine?
I mean, if I wanted to stay outdoors, are there any springs or geographical locations that would be warmer than others?
Not that I'm aware. Well, you know, you'd better ask an Emmeline, but I've not seen her for a few days.
Okay. Thank you.
Have no skills to search the dying flower stall, but I think there's something there because that's supposedly the dwarf, that lady that went missing or something like that.
Yep.
Yeah. What skills would you use to search?
Nature for the flower stall would be the first thing that I would think of.
General search for something out of place or something different that I don't know.
I mean, I've got 1 point into dungeoneering. That's the closest I have.
See, I have alchemy, but Eddie's not really good at talking, so me talking to that tiefling wasn't a very good idea in my opinion.
Oh.
Because, like, unless Eddie's religion is going to help, I don't.
What's that, Phil?
You know alchemy? Do you have, like, 1 point, 2 point, a lot of points?
I have a couple, but it's mostly like food focused because I took like chef stuff. Oh shit, I got 4 points, my bad.
Ben, maybe you know something about the Rathacadians.
Well, no, that's be like more like arcana. And the other dude only knew it because he was a tiefling and it's apparently readily knowledge for tieflings. You should like roll your intelligence.
I'm a tiefling. I know about these things.
You spend more time with the regular people than other tieflings.
Yes. I'm a tiefling. I want to win, but part of me goes, I have so many ideas how I could fuck things up, but like I don't want to kill an entire village full of people with my idiocy. I know I should just mobilize everybody until the big fluffy crocodile demons are coming. Everybody die.
Here's the
there were horses, and when there were 3 statues today and not 2.
Just based purely on the meta knowledge of last year's game, we're not gonna win. Fuck it up, buddy.
I mean, let me tell you about 75% to 90% of what Penance episodes are, fucking everything up.
You give us a lot more credit than that.
Well, in that case, I guess the question is how many people win? Because I kind of want to win.
Like, who often wins at tabletop? Not me.
I win. Most of my games, my characters win. Even when they lose, they win.
Alright, are we ready, guys? We're going to go check out a flower shop?
Yeah, let's see what we might be able to discern.
So you walk over to the deserted flower shop. It's very much the flowers here look like they've been picked maybe about 3, maybe 4 days ago. Most of them look badly wilted and slightly sort of brown around the edges.
So, Eddie has like 3 points in nature. I want to check this thing out. I want to see, like, is there anything out of place? Is there something here that shouldn't be, like, in a flower shop and stuff like that?
Roll. 14. Most things seem to be what you'd normally call out of place. There is one flower you don't recognize. two or three of them, and as you lean down and smell, they do have a very pungent, sweet smell coming out of them, even though they look wilted.
Like standard flower smell, or...?
It's like incredibly sweet, like substantially more sweet than most flowers would smell.
And they look dead, but they still smell...
They still smell quite... They still smell a bit as strong as a normal flower would, but they look like they've wilted quite badly. So it looks like if they had been fresh, they would smell substantially more pungent.
Eddie would like to take one.
Yep.
Can you explain why you take one?
He's going to look at gobshit and just kind of like point at it and then put it in between like a couple pieces of paper and fold it up and put it in his pocket.
Are there two others?
There are a couple of others, yeah. You can take them if you want.
Can I take two?
Yep.
Take two.
Sure.
I look around for like a vase to put water in, or something to put water in, and I put water in it and one of the flowers.
Alright, you sort of look around the back of the flower shop. You do find a couple of very simplistic clay vases that you can fill with water if you want.
Okay, I only want to fill one with water, so I want to put one flower in one, and the other one I'm going to like toss in fire and see if that does anything. And I'll put one in water and kind of keep an eyeball on it for now.
Yep, sure.
The other one I'll hang on to.
So you're going to find a fire to put that one in now, or are you just going to keep it and use it later?
I'll keep it, and wherever we go to, I'm pretty sure someplace will have a torch, a fire, something like that I can toss it into and see if it does anything weird.
Your choice for the next time slot is the inn or the sort of garden hut.
I heard the most consensus for the inn at this next time slot.
I'm really divided. I can see the merit in both, definitely.
I feel the same. Both NPCs in both areas seem like they would have enough weight that if we can convince them that the threat is real, that they might be able to influence the people. I do think the lady there with the overgrown garden seems like she would be inclined to believe us a little bit more, but as it was pointed out, maybe the gentleman in the inn would be also inclined to believe, especially if he's seen anything weird. I mean, he has goats, so things may have attacked his goats, too.
I think my character would be more interested in meeting Maud. If she's the local witch lady, there may be something I can learn from her. So that would be my in-character vote.
Which way you want to go?
Gob's voting for Maud.
Grass Hut it is!
Alright. So you make your way towards the sort of single house with a very overgrown garden outside. And as you approach, you see that there's definitely light coming from the window. There's definitely someone in. And as you approach, the door is closed and locked in front of you. What do you want to do?
Knock on the door.
You knock on the door and you hear a... What?
You knocked, Ixion, and take it away.
I'm thinking. Good evening, ma'am. I'm sorry to disturb you.
At this point, you hear the door being unlocked, and a sort of maybe about middle-aged looking human with long black hair standing in front of you, and she goes, "Well, you're not Reese, so that gives you a couple of minutes of my attention. What is it I can do for you?"
Well, we were hired to come out here to look into the caravan that crashed a few weeks ago. We heard that you might have a survivor that we were hoping
to meet with him inside. What about him?
Well, we were just hoping that we'd be able to speak with him to get a better idea of what happened.
Well, I suppose you can. He's not really making much sense, but I suppose if you have been sent to speak with him, come with me. And she opens the door and gestures you in.
Thank you.
So as you walk in, inside is completely immaculate. Like, everything's sort of very in its place and, like, exactly where it should be. There's nothing untidy at all inside the house. And off to the back left of the house, there seems to be a sort of a sick bed with a very light curtain wrapped around it. And inside, you see there's a definite humanoid who seems to be shivering quite violently under a blanket.
Chestburster.
Go up to the bed, I guess.
You walk up, you see a kind of youngish, maybe 30-ish year old human with sort of thick black hair, and it looks like he's got a very cheap looking beard, like it's kind of overgrown, kind of haggard, and he seems to be sort of like rocking back and forth and going and Maud just walks over with him and goes,
"That's about as much sense as I get out of him, that and shouting about something fluffy."
If I can make a picture of the fluffy thing, do you think that would shock him out further out of it or further into it?
What do you mean, a picture of the fluffy thing?
An illusion.
Yeah, an illusion of what I think it looks like.
Are you showing it to Maud, or are you showing it to the man?
I'm not going to show it to either one of them just yet. I want to ask her what she thinks. Like, do you, I think a...
You're going to show him an illusion?
Yes. I think this is the creature that attacked it. We were hired to retrieve a breeding pair of what we believe are Horrificadians.
What?
You heard.
I just want to make sure I heard exactly what you said.
In that case, I slide between the patient and her, turn toward her, and make an illusion of the thing that I saw pop off the fountain that I tried to grease and take a picture of that, and then I'll describe what happened there. Does the name Graveheart mean anything to you? And show a picture of the necromancer, who is not at all a necromancer.
He just looks like another lost boy. But what is this about Rathacadians? They're not real. If they are real, they're very, very expensive and shouldn't be anywhere near here. Should be in a castle somewhere, kept under lock and key, not set loose in the country.
Yeah, about 30,000 gold each, from what I gather.
Well, for the breeding pair. A middle-aged, scrawny desk-type pencil pusher hired us to retrieve two small, very fuzzy things. He used up all of his money and half of his guilds. He is the,
For God's sake, can't people be trusted with money anymore?
She sort of walks over to a library area and picks out a book and starts flicking through it. Until she comes to something and then goes,
"Let me just reread my notes on these."
She starts, like, running her fingers through very sort of doctor's script handwriting on the page in front of her, including, and you can see in the bottom corner, there's a picture very similar to the image you've shown her.
Oh.
The man on the bed screams, an ear-shattering scream.
Oh, found it.
So he basically backtracks himself off the bed, lands with a very sickening, and knocks himself out cold.
I will attempt to put him back on the bed.
At this point, the Maud looks over and goes,
"Well, that was definitely a reaction. Some more sense than he's made horses in the last few days.
They've eaten four horses. We think they're at the crash site up near Daddy's place."
"Well, that would be the crash site of the caravan, yes.
And the nice lady at the flower stall hasn't been seen for the past few days. Nobody's seen any of the horses."
Point at his face and then point outside.
"Tell me, have you spoke to Daddy about this?"
"No. We had a choice between Daddy's place and here. Chose here."
"Hmm.
I figured if he didn't know about this, this would be old wives' tale. But you're the village witch. I'm told
who
they
describes me as the village witch?"
"That would be the tiefling who's running out of town as quickly as..."
"Bloody Grunnings."
"Yes, well, Grunnings told me they lay a clutch between 30 and 35, and they have a breeding span
35?
Of
35? It's surely closer to 50.
"Well, then how is their breeding cycle? Because the crash happened 2 weeks ago."
She sort of looks at you in her eyes. Like, you notice her eyes are trying to go wide, but she's quite good at controlling her eyebrows and goes,
"That's a very worrying piece of information."
"I know."
"Hmm.
I've got flashbangs to try and cause a bit of an avalanche, but I don't know if we could seal everything in."
"We don't even know for sure if they're in the caves, though."
"Well, if they're the same thing that caused this reaction in the gentleman here, they're probably going to be a Rathacadian. Either that, or someone's gone really quite vibrant in dyeing their dog."
"Well, it certainly looked enough like a statue when our boy here tried to smash it."
"A big sheepdog-looking statue." I'm told they
where
can't.
Where did you attempt to smash it?
Eddie points out the window.
The fountain.
There were two
deaths. Interesting.
Except for a little while ago, three.
Well, it's definitely worth keeping an eye on, definitely. I think tomorrow we shall have to have a word with Daddy about things, see if we can work out what best to do. And we can abandon the village, I guess, but by the time we convince everyone to actually leave, we'll definitely be overthrown.
Are the young as dangerous as the adults? Do they come out terrifying?
Well, they come out as very large teeth, very sharp claws, hungry. Typically, what'll happen is the parents typically like leave meat in the area where the eggs hatch. And when the young hatch, they sort of feast. Well, that's my understanding anyway.
And how large are the eggs?
They're about, she looks at Eddie and goes, about the size of your companion there. Well, his torso, anyway.
Yeah.
Like 2 feet tall? I thought gnolls were huge, so I'm a little confused.
Gnolls are, like, tiny. Well, let's say tiny. They're about the size of, like, dwarves and halflings.
Oh, okay. All right, so...
But they're usually a lot... Usually, in my understanding of gnolls, is usually they're about three to 4 foot tall.
Okay, cool.
1.5 feet.
Wait, how big do these things get as adults?
Well, the fact that they can polymorph, they can be rather large. The largest one I have on record, and she flicks through her book and then comes back to pointing, the largest one I have on record is about the size of Clydesdale horse.
Oh.
They're, when they're large, they're, quite difficult to control. That's why they're usually kept in dungeons.
And now we have a pair out on the surface.
Yeah. This is not boding well for anyone, but panic will get us nowhere.
Do you know the earliest in their life they can breed? Like, how old?
She flicks through her notes again and goes, I don't seem to have that information. I'm sorry. I would probably suspect they've got to be at least a year old before they can breed, but that's maybe being far too... leaning far too much into what I'd hope rather than what is actually possible. Maybe they're like kittens. Maybe they can breed from a very young age.
Yeah, if they're born pregnant.
Don't think they could be born pregnant, but it would be a very few months and then they'd be good to go. It wouldn't be ideal.
I don't suppose you happen to know if there's a hot spot down at the bottom of the valley or the mines where they might be located?
No, the mines have been empty for a while after that. Well, I'm told after that poor gentleman was crushed under a large rock. But as far as I'm aware, there's no real hot spots nearby. None that I know of, anyway.
Do you know for sure if cold adversely affects them?
I don't really know.
We don't really have that
information in these notes I have. I mean, typically it's just what they are and how to spot them and, you know, what to be aware of. It doesn't actually say what hurts them.
Do your notes happen to mention where they like to build their nests at?
It says, she flicks through the pages again, and just says somewhere dark and sort of isolated.
I imagine a long silencing character.
I agree. perhaps, I know the caves, we've learned that they had been sealed up after that accident, but... perhaps these things have made their way back into them.
I would probably think that if they had been broken into the mines as... Well, you hear stories about things that live in the mines below many villages, but as far as I'm aware, Daddy had them completely sealed. Maybe we should speak to him about where they were. Maybe he'll know more.
Hey, I've got a couple of silly questions which may or may not be relevant. So... Mm-hmm. I've got this weird little flower right here, and I show her the one in the vase.
What are you doing with these pink bells?
Being crazy? I don't know. It seemed like a good idea at the time.
They're just local flowers, really. They're very pungent. They bring quite a lot of insects.
Okay. And they don't do anything special when they're burned or anything?
Well, I think they produce a scent, but again, all I can imagine it does attract insects.
I don't suppose
use a lot in beekeeping, if I believe.
What is your book? What do your notes say about how to recognize them or what to do, other than possibly run?
It just basically says you need to treat them like a mimic. Really, you sort of look at the object you're considering if might be them, and if it starts breathing, it's probably an Arthurcadian or a mimic.
Nice.
Apparently it's hard to see them in the cold, because then, you know, you can see the breath come out.
Will you come with us tomorrow to speak with Daddy?
Yes, I suggest we go early morning. He should be out in his field.
And unless we have any more business tonight, we may want to get some rest while we can.
I suggest you do. I imagine that you can probably get yourself very easy accommodation at the inn. Unless particularly you want to sleep on the floor here.
Out of character, does anyone else have anything to do here?
Does it mention anything in your notes about what kind of shapes or forms these creatures like to take? Or do they kind of run the gamut on whatever's convenient?
Most of the time it seems to be shapes and objects. They like statues, they like stone things, they like anything that they can sort of see and take in, as it were, they can transform into. So it can be a signpost, a statue, a door, a box, anything really, as long as they've had time to sort of examine it, really.
Not so much turning into people, right?
Oh no, they don't tend to turn into people, no. They tend to turn into stationary objects.
Okay, and they can't move, right? As a stationary object?
They can move, they can leap from where they are into attack from quite a fair distance away, but they have to turn back into their original form. They can't move as the object, no.
Okay.
Out of character, where were those books that were recovered? Where did they say they went to again?
Town Hall.
Thank you.
The boy, did he have any strange marks on him?
When he came in, I thought he just had a bad shock, and he had these two... He sort of leans his unconscious body forward a little bit and shows you the back of his neck. He's got two very obvious bite marks on both sides of his neck. So I thought it was just shrapnel at first. I mean, that fall, that 20-meter fall down onto lots of splintering wood will leave marks similar, but I never thought it would actually teeth mark.
Is there any reason this beast would bite someone but not eat them?
Well, he might have been able to pull his head away in time. They might have just leapt at him, and maybe he got startled. I mean, he did seem to be sprayed with horse blood when he arrived as well, so maybe they went for the horses.
I didn't
actually get to examine the horses. They seemed to have disappeared before I was able to look at them. Must ask Daddy what happened to them.
One last question. Assuming that Daddy doesn't believe us immediately, and thinks that maybe we're just trying to pull the wool over his eyes or scam or something, can you think of anything else that like fits all these different facts?
I mean, if you have actually seen the creature, then that does speak a lot. I mean, the effect that your friend's illusion seemed to have on this, my patient, kind of speaks for itself. I mean, if you just came in here saying you're looking for one, I would probably have thought you insane.
If we think of any other questions, I'm sure we can ask on the way there. Thank you very much for speaking with us and helping us try to save your town.
Yes, well, equally as I do say, panic doesn't seem to solve much, though we are on deadline, so let us see what we can do. You sting... At mods, are you going back to the inn to get night's rest? What are you doing?
I think we'd be more comfortable at the inn.
I think there's less of a chance of Mod getting eaten at the inn at here.
Oh, true. Votes?
My character would heavily push for us to go back to the inn. The floor is quite dirty.
I can clean the floor. Clean, 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 clean. By the way, do you have any toilet paper I can buy?
No. And still kind of cringes a little bit looking at the floor.
We'll get up off of being curled on the floor and get ready to head to the inn, because these three casters never like to get dirty.
So you head to the inn. As you walk in, there's a small, very young dwarf working the bar. You just say you want some rooms, he just hands you some keys.
Oh, I need to go to the bathroom. Where's that at?
The what?
The outhouse, the bathroom.
Oh, right. It's just out there. And he points out sort of back door of the inn. Very rickety-looking wooden box with a hole in the middle.
Eddie's going to pat him on the back.
Do I happen to see any toilet paper or something to wipe with from where I am? Do you have any toilet paper here, good sir?
Any what?
What do you wipe with here?
Well, we sort of, you know, use the water over there, and he points to a small box containing several jugs and a large bathtub next to it, and he goes, so, you know, go there and clean up.
I shudder. I'll go to my room.
I will go to my room.
Same.
Long before that transaction was complete, I would go to my room.
Alright, so the next morning, early morning, your choices are Town Hall, Market Square, and the Forest.
I assume the Forest is kind of on our way to Daddy's. Like, that's why we can't skip directly to Daddy's, right?
Yep.
Before I leave the inn, I ask the man if he has any spare socks. The young boy.
Any what?
Spare socks. Do you have any socks, kind sir?
Put them over your talking about. What do you mean by socks?
I look down. Is he barefoot?
Yep.
Oh. Is he a dwarf?
Yep.
Oh. Are there any humans employed here?
Well, you don't really employ anyone. Well, I suppose you can count myself. I mean, there's Patrick.
Can I talk with Patrick real quick before I leave?
Hang on a minute. He sort of stands up on the bar and starts clanging a ladle onto the bottom of a metal tin. He goes, Patrick! Patrick! And eventually this sort of like, comes from the back of the room. He's over there.
Okay. Then I go over there.
Go over to him and you get this. What are you waking me up for? What's wrong?
I need your socks.
What?
I hold up a gold coin. I need your socks. I need all your socks.
Well, I've only got the one pair, but alright. And he leans down and takes these very hole-ridden socks off. Hands them to you.
Okay, one gold. And then the first thing I'm going to do is prestidigitate them clean. Then I'm going to prestidigitate them whole.
All right.
With stuff in my backpack, we're going to go.
Reese, what's this? I don't know. It's quite shiny, though. So as you leave the inn with these two idiots not sure what a gold coin actually is, are you going to do anything on the way to meet Maud before you go to the forest, or are you going to do something else?
I know we were supposed to go there first thing in the morning, but I will admit a small part of me wonders if we should go to the town hall. I mean, they did mention some books were taken there, and I worried that they might have been one of these creatures, but could just be nothing.
I mean, I imagine that if they were a solid mass of books, that would have been like mentioned if they couldn't take them apart. You know what I mean? Because this creature can't transform into a bunch of small things. One of the books, possibly.
At the inn, I ask if they have any cognac or bourbon or scotch.
Cognac?
Cognac.
Or bourbon? He sort of rakes around by the one he hears around the bottles and he goes, right, I've got a clear one. He slams a bottle in the bar with some clear liquid in it. I've got a brown one, and he slams a bottle with brown liquid in it. I've got a red one, and a bottle with red liquid in it. And I've got, well, I can only describe it as green. And he slams a green bottle on the bar and goes, I think that's all I got. Wait, oh, wait, no. And he sort closer and you hear the sound of him. He pulls out another one. He's very, very dark red. Looks like a bottle of wine. He puts it in there. I got a dark red one. Any of that what you're after?
Can I sniff them before I buy them?
Sure.
I pop the top on the red one. How strong does it smell?
The wine bottle or the other lighter red one?
The dark red one.
It smells like very strong, very old, very good wine.
Okay. I kind of keep that in mind, recork that, and go over to the brown one. I pop that and smell that. Now, which one of these is going to go better with my cigar?
The brown one smells like very strong dwarven whiskey.
Ooh, that one. Yeah, brown.
All right. Want one bottle. I've got another one down here somewhere.
I think one will do it.
All right, then. And he starts clearing the other bottles away and just goes back to what he was doing.
All right. Now, fire is bad, but I don't intend to set this shit on fire ever.
Are you meeting up with Mod before you go, or are you just going there on your own?
Mod is good. Gotta keep her alive.
You walk up to Mod's hut. She's standing sort of outside, waiting, sort of admiring the incredibly long grass outside of her house. And she goes, right, well, I guess it's time to go and speak to Daddy.
Ask her if she smokes.
No, it's a filthy habit.
Sorry to hear that. I light a cigarette up. Or cigar up.
You know how many fires are started by absent smokers?
I assure you, I've never ever started a fire.
Yeah.
Would you like a bottle of dwarven whiskey? It goes really well with the cigar. With my cigar.
I mean, if you ever want to drink anything, you should drink rubbing alcohol. It gets you far drunker, and even then, it's not good for you.
I shall have to find out about this rubbing alcohol. I've never heard of it before. Smoke my cigar and drink my whiskey.
All right.
And today is going to be a good day, one damn way or another.
You make your way through the forest path, relatively picturesque, and after about 10 minutes you come out the other side and there's what looks like a pasture in front of you, where there's a large wooden fence, and there are several goats running around inside the fence. In front of the fence you see a sort of youngish looking dwarf with a very absent looking smile on his face, and you also see an older dwarf with like sort of black and white peppered hair kind of thing, who looks like he's not really old, but in that kind of like older side. What do you want to do?
I'd like to go and frolic with the goats.
Alright. So as Eddie runs in and starts frolicking with the goats, the sort of younger dwarf starts clapping and going, yay! And you hear the other dwarf go,
now Jack, come in. That's what you call a gnoll. You don't see them very often down this part of the world.
Gnoll.
Aye, that's it, Jack. You're getting it.
And at this point, the other dwarf turns to you and goes,
I assume that's your gnoll.
Yeah, it's my
son.
He's
friendly, all right, isn't he? I don't have to worry about my goats, do I?
I don't think he'll worry them that much.
Oh, that's fine, then. So you just on a wee walk, or you out here for a reason?
I'm here to scare the living shit out of you, hopefully.
Oh, well, good luck with that, son.
Have you heard of an Arathacadian?
Have you heard of a xylophone?
No, can't say that I have.
I love this game. Let's make it more words.
Okay, so let me tell you our tale. It involves me not getting paid, which I'm not happy about. However, I am a little tipsy and a little high, and I have a great cigar, so I don't mind. We got hired a day ago by some idiot up at the castle. Do I happen to know the idiot's name? I never asked.
The only thing that the work thing said was Kelvin. That was
okay.
You don't know if it's a first name or a last name.
Okay. I got hired up by some idiot named Kelvin. Kelvin looks like this. And I make an illusion of Kelvin. And I...
you hear the dwarf behind go, you see? Yeah.
Aye, Jack, it's an illusion. It's a wee thing mages do.
And the other dwarf starts clapping inanely, and he's like,
"Ah, yeah, that's nice to have you. You go play with the goats. I go keep that gnoll company. Apologies. Carry on."
Yes. she is a secretary to the Merchant Guild, and he got drunk one night. And then I make a smaller illusion of the guy named Graveheart, and he bought two small fuzzy things, them slightly bigger ears and rather sharper claws. They were came down on a caravan which went off the beaten path 2 weeks ago, straight through a wooden fence, I assume put up by you or someone of equal caliber.
Listen, object here, I be saying, are you telling me a story, or are you actually telling me what's happening? Because, well,
he points up and there's a sort of hanging fence at the top of the cliff behind him. He goes,
we kinda got that. So, do you mean the crash here?
Yes.
Right.
They're carrying...
You could have told me that rather than going in a wee story, but carry on, son.
Yes. This barbarian merchant, who is completely not at all a necromancer, I wish to make that clear.
That's good. It's good he's
Kelvin
not a necromancer.
Said he's not at all a necromancer, regardless of the black robe and the pale skin. He's not at all a necromancer. Happened to sell.
That's good. I don't know why you keep telling me that it's good, but I carry on.
He bought a breeding pair of Erethicadians from this man with about 30,000 gold, give or take. And we
think... That's a lot of gold.
Yes. We think they went off the rails, down the cliff, ate all the horses, attacked the driver, ate everybody in the cart, probably ate the nice lady who was at the flower stall. What's her name?
Emily.
Amelia. Emily. She hasn't been seen in 3 days.
I have no sign of her.
Yes. And seeing as how you're right close to this, have any of your goats been going missing, or horses, or...
I don't know that many. I mean, there's been about 3 or 4, but this time of year, some of them do go missing, and they sort of turn back up, you know, like pumpkins, if you know what I mean.
Yes. Well, Mog can vouch that when the driver saw a picture from her book of what the Rathacadian looked like, he freaked out so much that he knocked himself out in terror.
All right.
The woman looks at him and goes, they showed him this image and he sort of backpedaled himself really fast off the table and smacked himself unconscious on the floor.
Oh, well, suppose that has a reaction, aye? So, what we do about it, you know, we set some traps out, some dogs. What's your plan?
I was hoping there might be some way to completely seal them in. Not everybody needs to start running.
Seal them into what?
We think they're at the bottom of the cliff, and down there they found a nice dark place.
The cliff's there.
He turns around and points to a pile of like broken like wood just lying in the grass. He's just like,
that's where it fell.
I don't know the area. Are there any caves nearby?
Not to my knowledge. There's a couple of small hangover cliff bits that the goats go to, but most of them are not exactly nice in the weather.
Like they don't go very far back?
Aye, they only go about maybe a meter or two back. They're not deep enough that you'd have any, you know, shelter.
Not enough for, say, a pile of 50 plus and a clutch of eggs, about the same size as my null friend there.
Well, I got 50 eggs the same size as your null.
Yeah.
Are we talking 50 eggs together, the size of your null?
Each.
Right, okay, well, that's not going to fit in any of the caves I know of. That's a conundrum.
At this point, you hear the dwarf going, eggs! Eggs! I like eggs!
Aye, Jack, eggs are great, aren't they? Aye. Sorry, he's a wee bit... You know, he's got bad brain damage, is Jack.
Recent, or...?
At this point, Maud goes, oh, it's been a few years now, because these people decided that he should dress up as a mouse and get beaten to death with sticks.
Maud, it wasn't like that.
It was. When I turned up to this village, he'd only done it for 2 years and he could barely move. Brain damage, I'm surprised he can still walk. Or talk. Or even respond.
Look, take out Harris again, Mod. I've tried everything I can. I even got him that helmet you suggested.
Yes, and that helmet's the only reason he's probably still living, Daddy.
It keeps everyone else's spirits up. It's what all we can do. I mean, Jack's fine. I mean, Harris asked him last year if he still wanted to do it. And he's always happy to do the rap, you know?
That's because he's brain damaged.
Oh, he's not that bad, Mod. Come on, he's not that bad.
Look at him. He's got a smile on his face like from ear to ear all the time.
Ah, he's just a happy wee boy though, aren't you, Jack?
Yay!
Ah, there we go, brilliant. Right. Lee and Jack out the way for this, right? What are we gonna do about this?
We've been told that you had sealed up the mines. Is it possible these things could have broken back in and settled into them?
I wouldn't have thought so. I mean, we properly sealed them after McCarthy was crushed by that rock. I mean, we didn't even get a chance to bury him. He's still crushed under that rock in that mine. His hand's sticking out, though. That's a glove puppet.
Would it be possible to have someone just double-check the entrances?
Well, you'd have to move all the stones away, but I suppose you...
Won't moving the stones away mean that you're effectively unsealing the mines?
Well, I suppose so, aye, but they were, last time we had anyone here, they were, like, buried with that stuff, ground cells, the, what's he call it, the sort of concrete-y stuff. He said he would seal it airtight, because there was someone was saying there was some kind of troll in the mine. I don't believe it for a, you know, we used to have, you know, a thing where the kids would try and break into the mine, so we had to seal them up proper, like.
Then, if any of the stones are missing or different, then that would be a good indicator.
I suppose so, aye. Well, I can have a look around them. Well, I'll go around them today, I suppose. Jack, you alright looking after the goats while I'm away?
I like goats.
Aye, there we go, Jack boy. You look after the goats. Daddy will be back soon.
You wanting to say anything else to him before he goes off to look at these, or...?
You may want to take someone with you. These creatures, they like to look like things they're not. They could easily decide to look like a stone or a tree or anything.
Just raises an eyebrow at you and goes,
well, what exactly am I looking for?
Looking for a rock that breathes.
A rock that breathes. Well, that's fucked, isn't it?
These things can take several different forms, and basically the best way to detect them is seeing if they show signs of life.
Alright. I guess I'll just be a bit more careful then. I'll go and check these out, and once I'm done I'll go and speak to Harris.
Just so you're perfectly clear of what you're getting yourself into, if you find one of these and you don't have anyone to help you take it down, you will die. They're very fast.
I don't need to worry. I've had enough experience in my life to know how to get away from creatures.
I ask Maud, where could they possibly hide in this area that isn't the mine?
I'm not really sure where they could go. I mean, they could be in any building, really, couldn't they?
I mean, it's just dark and abandoned, right? That's what they look for.
Don't think it even needs to be abandoned. It just needs to be somewhere that they're not bothered. Maybe like a cellar or something.
That's what I was about to ask. Is there any cellars that the buildings in town have?
I'm not sure with most of the buildings in town. Maybe Daddy knows. And she sort of shouts after them, and he sort of turns around and goes,
what? That's a good question. I've not thought of that. I'd ask Harris. He'll probably know. He was here when a lot of the dwarves took over from the humans and the mining and all that. He knows a lot of weird shit is in the building. Plus, he's also got his gin stored there, so, you know, he knows all these nooks and crannies.
Yeah, because there was one hiding in the middle of on the fountain. It would stand to seem that it was closer. That's a question. Why was it there, not here?
What do you mean, why was it there, not...
Well, I mean, there's two statues on your fountain, right?
Oh, wait, never mind. Caesar and Antonio, that was it. That was the two dogs that looked after the chasing the rats out of the village.
When we came here, there were three. And what? Eddie was playing, and he smacked one with a stick, and he smacked another with a stick, and when he went to go smack the third one, the thing changed back into one of these Arethicadians and took off.
He'll hold his stick high as he runs by.
Yes, that stick. A mighty stick it was.
Alright, okay. That's a good technique you got there. Best thing I can suggest is you speak to Harris. He's probably got the best idea of what's got a basement below.
I'd like to go over to Jack. And kind of do that crouch that you do to, you know, kids to kind of get on eye level.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, buddy, how's it going?
He's great. He got the goats and the furry boy.
And he points at Eddie.
Yeah, you look like you're doing a great job with the goats.
Yeah.
Buddy, you said earlier that you like eggs. I'm looking for some really special eggs.
Oh, I know where they are.
Yeah?
They're in the trees.
And he points to a tree nearby that's got an obvious bird's nest in it.
I'm looking for bigger eggs and a whole bunch of them.
And he looks like he's thinking and he's looking around, pointing at each tree and then going like, oh no, that's the same size. He's just spinning in circles, like pointing at the tree really slowly. Like he's lost in thought.
I'll give him time.
Okay. He just keeps looking around in circles and going like,
there's lots of eggs everywhere.
Alright, great job, buddy. Well, if you see any really, really big eggs, could you have someone let me know?
Like an owl.
Bigger.
Ooh.
He looks like he's really deep in thought now.
I make an illusion of a null torso-sized egg.
He's going to show him a very large egg.
A humongous egg.
Like this size.
Ooh, I've seen that.
You have?
Yeah.
Can you tell me where?
In the square.
Where in the square?
Under the dogs.
The dogs move?
And he looks under himself.
He sort of looks like he's really puzzled about what to say.
How deep is that fountain? Like, if it's 20 feet deep, but it only looked like it was 3 feet deep for us. You know what I mean?
No.
I think it'd be a good idea to take another look at that fountain when we get back to town. Either check the depth of it or see if maybe the fountain moves some.
Jack, do you know how the egg got under the fountain, bud?
It fell through the grating.
Oh, okay. Could
it
you
start
see
twitching
the
yesterday? It looks like it's going to hatch soon.
Well, that's really exciting.
Yeah.
Well, those eggs are really special to me, and it would be very upsetting if anything happened to them. So if you see anyone going near them, or really, I'd rather that you don't go near them just in case. I don't want them to break.
You've got to be very quiet, otherwise the eggs don't move.
The eggs move when you're not quiet?
If you watch them and you're very quiet, they move.
I'll keep that in mind and I'll be very quiet and watch them.
The horse watches too.
The horse?
There's a horse. It's sleeping. It watches it too.
Is the horse under the fountain?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is Maud listening?
At this point, Maud's still talking to Daddy.
I'm going to walk over to Maud.
Jack, you've been such a big help. You're doing such a great job, bud.
Yay!
Yeah, keep them talking.
About what?
Where they're at.
I mean, they're under the fountain. I assume that Maud and Dad know more about that.
Hey, I go up to Maud. Hey, apparently underneath the fountain there's a grate. Jack says he's seen some eggs and they move if you're real, real quiet.
What? Do you know anything about this? And Daddy goes,
well, it was a great to get onto the mechanism of the fountain, but never been down there.
Avair will walk over and add, it looks from what he's told, the young man's told us, there might be a horse down there too. Might be the ones that went missing from the stables.
How'd you get a horse under a fountain?
Well, maybe not a whole horse.
Yep, send pieces. It'd probably be pretty easy to move.
Want to have a whack-a-day festival a day early? And we just go down there? I'll pay you 1 gold for every, like, egg that you smash.
I think you should be very careful about going down there.
Who is it you're offering the gold to?
Well, Daddy's a villager chief, right?
Kind of.
I ask him, do you think the villagers would go for a pre-whacking day whacking?
Well,
a pre-whackening.
If we could get rid of this ant problem, then it should be a good idea, aye.
Killing all the eggs, I imagine, would get rid of the problem.
Assuming you're not mature enough to live out of the shell already.
Gotta make sure no one tries to burn them.
Mm-hmm.
So, do we have anything else to continue doing here, guys?
I'm ready to move on. Maybe talk to some other people about going down the grate.
Your choice for the next one is the town hall, the inn, the market square, or Maud's hut.
Do we waste time and go somewhere else, or do we go straight for the problem and see if we can win, as per Phil's words?
Well, Phil wanted to hire a bunch of people to go down there and whack the shit out of some eggs. Not at all meat shields, mind you.
You've got to sacrifice a village to save a continent?
I wouldn't put it that way. I just think it would be a good idea if we had more help smashing the eggs. Because we have some eggs that are starting to hatch, and then we get attacked. It'll be much more difficult to smash the eggs while we're being attacked. On the other hand, if we have a bunch of people who are smashing eggs, then we can deal with the attack.
You really think we're capable of dealing with the attack? Honestly.
What level are we?
Yes.
We're like level 5, level 20, level 1.
Uh-huh. Nikolai and that Penance really doesn't really use levels so much in the one-shots.
Okay. Well, I'm not even sure what spells I have. At this point, I assume that I had Prestidigitation. It's like the first level cantrip. I don't know what my offensive artillery looks like, if any. I have a wand of fire and that's it, and that's useless because it's a wand of fucking fire that heals them.
This won't heal the enemies. I have a wand of ice, but, I mean, that's assuming that it does anything. Avair has a wand of lightning, I believe.
Yeah.
Well, we got all the elements down.
Well, I've got a butter knife and a cheese grater.
John, you can make us some omelets, but that's awesome.
I was going to make a joke earlier about you got to break a few eggs to make an omelet.
Guys, I will so go in cheese grater and a butter knife and come out making you omelets if we have to.
Dedication.
I do think if we can rally some people, it would help, but I don't know if the time spent would be advantageous.
This next time slot, what time of day is it?
This is getting into afternoon.
So if we go to the markets, pretty much everybody's going to be in the market?
If you go to the market, then at least the stall owners are going to be there. Well, the stall owner is going to be there since the tiefling's disappeared. So the blacksmith is definitely going to be there.
And if we go to the town hall?
There might be other people there.
We haven't been there yet, so we don't know.
Well, we can ask Maud and Daddy. Like, if there were normally people in town hall at this time of day.
This time of day, usually Harris is about this.
We haven't spoken to Harris yet.
My only concern is gestation, is how much longer do we actually have less before kaboom?
I mean, if they're gonna hatch today, they're gonna hatch today. Like, I don't think that if we if they were set to hatch today, and we go in there and start cracking the eggs, I don't think it's going to kill the little fuckers, because they were going to hatch today anyway. They would be functional today and starving anyway. So I don't see a huge difference between in the shell and freshly hatched. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes awesome sense, actually. I definitely want to hire some egg smashers.
I would rather have extra bodies.
Oh, well, you're in the lead. Eddie is the dumb cook to you smart mages, so carry on.
So to town hall, then?
Well, we can ask Maud and Daddy, would we find more people at the town hall, the market square, and where was the other place?
Maud's hut.
Don't think Maud's hut's going to help us gather bodies.
We could go to one place and ask them to go to the others and rally people.
That's kind of what my thinking was, that we could go to the town hall, talk to Harris, correct? From there, if we could get him to rally people and have them meet us at the market, then we could go down and try to flush these things out or deal with them.
In a very complex and very long series of hand gestures, Eddie is going to try and convey about, could Aovar reverse engineer the fountain to flood below and then Ixion freeze it, and then in that freeze maybe release some lightning? And then after that, I'm just going to shrug my shoulders.
That's an interesting idea.
That's a very interesting idea.
I mean, Aovar is an engineer.
Yeah, that might be something I could try. That would also probably give us more time to figure out a long-term solution, especially if the lightning itself didn't do anything.
Could we freeze them permanently and turn around and sell them?
That doesn't seem like the responsible option.
That sounds like the awesome option.
Very profitable, but not responsible.
On the other side, if we freeze them, it's basically ice. It's going to be water that's, you know, completely going to encase what amounts to eggs, and then you're going to freeze the water around the eggs, and the resulting ice is probably going to crush the egg.
I mean, whether they live or die, we still win, but if we can, like, get profit out of it and win?
That would be great, because I don't think What's-His-Face is going to fucking pay us. Yes.
Yeah, no.
And Mr. Gravemind needs to have a bad thing happen to him by somebody who gets paid.
Horrible people, let's do it.
I need to ask the DM a question. With my 6 in Arcana and my 3 in Lore, do I think that the Wand of Ice will be able to freeze all the water and then use the Wand of Lightning to zap the resulting ice cube?
As I'm sure Eddie will tell you, anything is possible with the games I run, so fuck it, go ahead.
If the dice are on your side,
you can do anything.
All I gotta say is if you roll well, we accomplish.
Oh, yeah.
I hope you got a lot of points in engineering. Or tinkering.
Are you heading to the town square, then?
That sounds like the plan.
Yes. Okay, let's do it.
Right, so you head to the town square with Maud and Daddy in tow. And as you arrive in the town square, you basically start looking around this fountain. Can everyone roll me an awareness check, please, to see if you can find the area that you're looking for?
I got a 15.
Yep, you look around the fountain, you find 2 grates. You find one at the front and one at the back. The one at the back seems to have a blood trail leading from the stables to it.
Well, there's
nobody noticed.
It is no, the back of the fountain, so it's bushes and trees and stuff behind it. But there's a definite blood trail from the back door of the stables to here.
All right, so how do we flood it?
All right, so first I guess I need to examine the fountain. How does it look like the water is being produced out of this fountain?
It looks like most of the sort of engineering that goes into the fountain is underneath the fountain itself. There's something underneath that causes the water to like shoot up and out.
Okay. All right, closer examination of this would lead me to believe that either I might be able to redirect some water coming out of the top down, but that might not be a fast enough flow, in which case the water might not fill quick enough for us to do what we plan. The other option would be to go down there and very carefully and somewhat quietly cause a disruption and flood it that way. Though that could be very dangerous for a couple different reasons.
I would greatly prefer to not physically enter if at all possible. Do I have, like, create water or something that could assist in this?
There's quite a lot of water in the fountain itself, so you could just bluntly just get a bucket and just chuck from the fountain.
Oh, let's do that.
Oh, not to make it more easy than you want it to be.
Easy is good.
Yes, easy is safe.
It's a bar grating. Are you wanting to lift the bar grating or just throw the water through it?
Throw the water through it.
All right.
That will give things that try to come out of the grating less chance.
All right. So you're just going to keep throwing buckets of water down through the grate?
Yeah.
As you do this, the blacksmith walks over and goes, "Here, what are you up to?"
"There's big nasty monsters downstairs, and we need you to help us, like, grab a bucket and push and put more water down there. Because see the big blood trail leading from the stables all the way down?"
He turns around and sees and goes, "Oh God, that's a lot of blood, that. Wonder if Luther's alright. He's not turned up for work today."
"Yeah, he's dead."
"What do you mean he's dead? How do you know that?"
"Dead. Downstairs killed him."
"The what?"
"I mean, he's dead and the things downstairs killed him. If you want to go down there and look at him, well, frankly, you can die too. Or you can just grab a bucket and help us." "Like, I want to kill them without them coming out, you know. I don't want to deal with that. No.
I'll go get you some buckets then." He sort of walks off with a really bewildered look in his face.
"And grab a bunch of people too. And maybe some hammers."
All right. So he sort of wanders off and he sort of comes back a couple of minutes later and going, "I brought Ethel. No one else is in the town square, and Grunens has gone away, and for what you're telling me is right, Luther's dead, and Emmeline's not here anymore. The village is getting a bit quiet now."
"Yeah, look around."
At this point, this very enthusiastic dwarf next goes, "Oh, hello there, I've been told that there's something wonderful going on under the fountain. Can you please tell me more?"
"I'm sorry, you are?"
"I'm Ethel. Hi.
Oh, no, cool.
Are you going to do something magical under the fountain? Oh, I'll go and get the children. The children would love to see this. Just stay here, I'll go and get them."
"Don't do that unless you want your children dead."
As Ethel run.
"Don't worry, they're very good looking after themselves. They don't fall over things anymore. They're getting quite good."
As Ethel runs off, I'm going to point at my mallet.
"Hey, get the buckets. We're having the day early. It's a practice whackening day."
Alright. So are you basically going to spend the next, like, hour or so pouring water under the fountain?
"Yeah, how many charges do our stabs have?"
"As many as you want."
"Oh. Every now and then we just zap it with lightning."
Alright, so you're going to zap the water with lightning?
"Oh, hopefully not while we're standing in it, but yes. I mean, we're going to chuck water down there, and every now and then we'll zap what we can down there. Please, somebody who actually has lightning."
The first time you zap, there's a sort of spark, and you hear the sound of... And there's a small bit of smoke starts wisping out the edges.
I immediately freeze after the zap.
After a couple of seconds, there's definitely, like, at least a little black smoke wisping its way out of the edges of the fountain.
"More water?"
More water. Lots more water.
Can we peek down there and see how this is going?
Yeah, you look down there, there's definitely a small fire because something is glowing down there.
"What the hell is that that's glowing? Can I tell from here?"
Do a roll to stick your head in, see if you can see.
"I don't want to stick my head in. Right. I'm dreadfully afraid of sticking my head in."
All right.
If you're not going to do it, Eddie will stick his head in and do like a Scooby-Doo.
Hold on 1 second. I'll take out my spyglass and kind of try and see if...
Awesome.
Roll. Yep, you look through the spyglass, through in. You see that somewhere underneath there is like a pile of what looks like straw, and on top of it seems to be a body. And the straw and the body are kind of on fire at the moment.
looks like it started a fire down there. There's some kind of straw that had made its way in there, and that's on fire, and it's catching a body on fire now, so...
Ice?
Yeah, I'd say either shoot ice down there, or maybe see if we can open up the side of this fountain and start draining this thing into it.
Do I have any spells that allow me to shape stone?
No, but you can just use a hammer.
While he's starting with the hammer, I'm going to go ahead and start zapping ice towards the fire.
All right, so do me a strength roll with your hammer to see how you do chipping away at this side of the fountain.
Retzup starts swinging with his hammer.
I rolled a 5.
Let's see, hammer break? Your hammer breaks. You do one slam down, the head of the hammer spins backwards, leaving you holding the stock. But Eddie, on the other hand, is managing to do chipping quite well and has managed to crack the fountain, so water's dripping through now.
Grab the mace out of my pack.
Alright. Roll strength to swing the mace.
Hey, if you can make a hole big enough, I can put the firework into it.
Well, there's already a crack based on the whirl I made.
The water's running through the fountain, the hole in the fountain, and it's trickling through probably about the same speed that you would, like, you know, dip a bucket in and pour it in.
Again.
Yep, you crack again the same spot. There's a substantial, like, break in it now. It's water's pouring through. And you notice it's beginning to slowly fill up, and the smoke is beginning to get less and less, and then there's a tss sound.
Oh, this is much easier. Let's just water this way.
Eddie is going to tug on Aevir and point at the water and point at your staff.
You mean the wand?
Yeah.
I'll step back and zap it with my lightning wand the side of the fountain, I mean.
All right, roll.
Nice.
20. There is a shuddering sound. It's like lots of like cracking sounds at once. After the sound, everything just goes very still and silent, and the only thing you can hear is the sound of the water running in. As you look into the water, it seems to start going from the sort of dark blue it was to a very murky, dark pink.
Eddie pulls out his frying pan.
Does look like it's filling up any?
It looks like it's filling up. It's getting closer and closer to the top of the grill, and as it's getting closer, this thick pink stuff seems more and more thick on top of the water as it's rising upwards.
I'd like to kind of take a look at the surroundings and see if there's anything inanimate breathing.
Sure. Do an awareness.
While she's doing that, are the eggs floating?
Nope. Though you do see the occasional like chunk of what looks like pieces of eggs floating in the water. Nah, natural one, you don't see much. Although you are assured that there's a tree that's breathing, and you, as you smack it with your mace gets wedged into it.
Sorry guys, this one's not breathing.
I see egg bits, and I see floating pink things, right?
Basically, you see floating chunks of egg, and the whole water is like thick, like pink viscous liquid. So the water now has changed color completely.
Doesn't mean anything to me arcane-wise, does it?
No.
Not unless you want to use weird bits of egg in future spells.
I take out a firework. I light it with my cigar. I wait until the fuse is almost down, and then I toss it into the hole.
Okay, roll. 3! You drop it at your feet. There was a massive boom.
I can.
Oh, explosive rolls. Natural 20, oh, no. You fly forward and go under the fountain.
I'm down in the goo?
You're down in the goo.
I rapidly look for a way out and try to make my way toward it.
As you like break back the surface, you are covered in this thick layer of like pink slime.
Okay.
There's a ladder you can use to climb out, but it's very difficult to move. You find every move is now, like, a lot heavier because you're covered in this goop.
Wipe the goop off as best I can and climb out.
Alright. Is that anyone helping? Or are you just going to stand by and watch?
He's laughing.
I mean, I've got a net, but I don't think that's going to help much in this situation.
My character is just like, nope, 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 nope. I'm not touching that. No, no, ew, no.
Eddie is treating Gob as like one of the Ghostbusters coming out of the sewers.
He's got about twice as much goop on him as one of them. Like, stands out, and the more he stands outside out of the water, he's just covered in this. He's come like a sort of almost like a golem. Just every single like part of him is just covered in this thick, almost statue-like pink slime.
Motherfucker!
I try to either break free, or failing that, I'm a light. Is my cigar still lit?
Do you want your cigar still to be lit?
Yes.
There's a massive explosion.
Okay.
You have now caught fire, and everything basically within a 2-meter range of you has caught fire.
Am I out of the statue-like pink stuff?
It's very flammable. And you're basically coated in it. Running around covered in very highly flammable goo.
Can I ice wand him?
Sure. Roll.
Y'all should stamp me out.
You shoot him, it whaps him in the stomach. He doubles over breathless for a second, but falls to the ground, holding his stomach, continuing to burn.
Eddie knows, you have to slam things out. He's going to use his mallet and try and put out the fire.
Yep, roll strength. You do substantial damage. There's a sound like a bone breaking, but you haven't put the fire out.
I'm going to try and scoop water out of the fountain with a bucket and throw on him.
Sure, roll. You throw water on him. The water just immediately just fizzles and goes off. It just doesn't seem to do anything. You have no eyebrows left.
Okay.
Your skin is slowly beginning to melt. It's pretty gnarly at the moment.
Can I wash it off with the whiskey?
What does whiskey do?
Think about that one, bud.
You pour the whiskey on yourself. There's like a sort of moment of almost dragon-like fire breath. Can everyone do me a dodge roll to make sure you're not coated with fire as well?
It seemed like a good idea at the time.
Well, Ixion's on fire as well. Wait to see how Eddie and Avea are doing.
Dodge roll is just a flat roll, or do I add anything?
It's a flat roll for this.
Yeah, of course.
Yep, Avea's fine. Eddie is very much on fire. So Eddie and Ixion are on fire. Avea is standing there like, I don't get how I'm not on fire, but everyone else is. People, everyone around start panicking and basically start throwing buckets of water everywhere.
Can I jump in the fountain?
Yep.
I would like to do that.
You do put the fire out, though once you stand up, you do notice the bits of them are still very lightly on fire. Like it must be some sort of chemical rather than a like straight oxygen fire.
Can I jump into the fountain?
Sure. Let's see what happens when you jump in the fountain. Yep. Although it does evaporate a substantial portion of the water, you are mostly not on fire anymore.
Let's see if Eddie can finish evaporating the water.
Yep. Eddie jumps in, hits the ground of the fountain, just lies there, and yeah, about a centimeter of water at the bottom, just like...
I'll take that.
At this point, you see the dwarf from earlier coming back with a troop of children behind him. Going, oh, we haven't missed the fun, children. They've just started. Look at that one in the fountain. It's all pink.
I'm going to start trying to forcibly remove the children from the situation.
All right. Oh, you can't take the children away. They're enjoying it.
The hell I can. I will throw my net on them if I have to and drag them away.
Come, children, let us help with the water. Let's have a water fight. She starts grabbing buckets of water and throwing them on people.
Yeah. As long as I can get a kid away, or a couple, preferably.
So just to clarify, is the fountain just, it, has it stopped producing water and is now just injecting this pink goo?
Basically, the water from the fountain, most of the upper part of the fountain is evaporated, and it's just still trickling out the pipework, but what's trickling out is just going straight down under, and this, like, pink goo is still just, like, it's just reached the surface, and it's just starting to spread out slowly around the edge of the fountain.
Okay. While you're trying to get the children away, Ixion, I'm going to take your ice wand, and I'm going to attempt to... I'd like to do two things. First, I want to freeze the water that's still coming out of the fountain. Mm-hmm. And then I would like to attempt to freeze the water that's actually down in the grate.
Roll 2d20 rather than 1. Natural 20 and a 3. Your attempt to freeze the water on top works. You've made like a plug out of ice. And you hear the sort of sound of the pipework below beginning to bend and buckle with the pressure. You can't seem to freeze the water through the pink goo. So at this point, you hear a voice screaming, "You're all going to die!" And the man you recognize as the patient from Maud's hut is running through town, waving his arms frantically, running towards the stable, desperately trying to break through the front of the stables. What do you want to do?
I'd yell back to him, we're trying to control the situation. Do you have something that can help?
Does he have any clothes on?
He's basically wearing a very thin linen shirt and a loincloth. He manages to break open the front door of the stables and begins to start trying to attach a horse very clumsily to the front of the one cart that's there.
Does anybody want to stop him?
I don't know what he's doing. Also, I'm quite badly hurt.
I'm still on fire.
Are there any buckets of mud? Like, can I throw dirt on top of him?
Yep.
I throw dirt on Edie.
No, you throw dirt on him, he panics more and somehow manages to spread the fire.
Just to be clear, is the pink goop in danger of rising out of the grate?
It has risen out of the grate and is beginning to make a sort of pink layer that's sort of expanding really slowly from the fountain going outwards.
I would like to help the patient hook up the horse so I can get the hell out of here. This place is gonna blow.
Alright. He hooks the horse to the front of this caravan. It looks like a caravan that was being prepared to go back down to the city anyway. And he jumps on the front and says, "I'm getting the hell out of here. What do you want to do?"
I'm jumping in wherever I can and encouraging my teammates to do the same.
I'm jumping on too.
Ditto.
What's Eddie still on doing fire. On fire?
And he's still on fire and he's trying to catch up with his teammates going...
Does the Burning Knoll make it? The Burning Knoll somehow manages to jump onto the cart. Oh, bounces God. Around a fair bit, but does manage to make it onto the cart.
Alright, I'm gonna try and find like a blanket or something to smother him in.
Alright. Okay, so you basically put the Knoll out and you enjoy your trip back to the town. Doing anything once you get back to the city, or are you just going, "Fuck this, this was a really bad decision," and never going near that inn again?
I'm not going near that city, near that inn, near this side of the continent.
Well, you keep in touch with a couple of people nearby, and you don't hear much about Luchgobar ever again. However, a couple of weeks later, more and more death seems to be spreading throughout the city. It appears that in your haste to get out of there, you brought the adults back with you to the city. The next few weeks are tinged with terror, bloodshed, and almost daily mages descending on the city trying to desperately hold back this tide of ravenous beasts. Close as you came, you have not saved the world.
Wow.
But you may not have saved the world, though you got the damn closest anyone's has so far. Where can folk find you? So, the floor is yours, take it away.
I mean, as usual, you can find us anywhere you can search Mystery Fantasy Dungeon 9000. We have a Twitter, we have a Facebook, and most of us socialize in Discord. Most of our social media is just pretty much share our episodes, but most of our active time is in the Mystery Fantasy Dungeon 9000 Discord. I can be reached through any of our social medias, and most of these slackers don't have a social media life, but you can find them as followed.
Myself, I mean, I could be found probably through Discord. I mean, I do get notifications from there more so than anything else. I will try to respond if I get a message, but MFD9k is going to be the best way to get in touch with me.
Same here. Hit me up on the Discord. I would be happy to hear from anyone if they take an interest in our group and have any questions.
Yeah, exactly what the two people in front of me said. I'm completely inactive socially, both online and in real life, pretty much. Mystery Fantasy Dungeon 9k at gmail.com. Once again, for those listening, it's Mystery Fantasy Dungeon 9k at gmail.com.
So, what is MFD9k doing these days?
Mostly, we just try to help new people get into 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons on the Discord. We have a helpful little fight club where people can come and learn new things. We don't put out episodes like a lot of other podcasts because we all have long hours at work, so we don't get to record as often as everybody else. But, I mean, we still enjoy what we do, and we try to help out people where we can, so that's pretty much it.
And although this is October when we're recording this, do you have anything special going on this month you'd like to plug as a bonus?
No, we're not that popular.
You don't have to plug stuff. Come on. What you got?
I mean, the only thing that we really have going on this month, if you actually listen to the our podcast and get the secret word, you can get extra entries into our monthly dice contest for this month and next month. Outside of that, that's our biggest event going on right now.
I'm sure we'll send some folk your way and hopefully everyone will enjoy it.
But all right.
Thank you very much to my guests this evening and good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.